This is time that we discuss John Donne. And John Donne is a contemporary of Shakespeare. Donne was born in 1572 and he died in 1631. And he was the leader of a group of poets known as Metaphysical poets. And actually the term Metaphysical poet was coined by Dr. Johnson. And he charged Donne and the other poets of the metaphysical school as people attempting to show off learning. According to Dr. Johnson, these people, John Donne and the other metaphysical poets, tried to show off learning. So in his lives of eminent poets, he begins the biographies with Abraham Cowley. And it is in the biography of Abraham Cowley he refers to the metaphysical poets as poets trying to show off learning. And he also accused these people of yoking together by violence. And this is one very important point. Dr. Johnson maintained the view that these poets tried to yoke together, join together by violence, by force. They forcefully tried to unify the most heterogeneous ideas. So the spiritual love and physical love, they are heterogeneous ideas. Ideas that we are not supposed to violate. But these poets, they tried to yoke together the most heterogeneous ideas. And the chief characteristics of metaphysical poetry were ruggedness of wits. And when we examine the characteristic qualities of metaphysical poetry, we come to identify that the metaphysical poetry noted for their ruggedness of wits and use of far-fetched conceits, and they used the far-fetched, the heavy conceits and the yoking together of things that are outwardly incompatible. And they tried to yoke together things that are externally incompatible, not to be united. And they actually put forward the most heavy conceits. And Dr. Johnson's attack on these poets had a terrible effect. And these poets were left in cold storage. With Dr. Johnson making the remark of the metaphysical poets were left in cold storage for about 3 centuries. Say for 300 years, people didn't try to read the poems written by the metaphysical poets. And the resurrection of these poets came only in the 20th century. A professor named Grierson brought out a volume of poems written by John Donne, entitled The Poetic Works of Donne in 1912. And it came to the attention of T.S. Eliot, and Eliot hailed the so-called metaphysical poets as models to be followed by all budding poets. Actually, these poets were left in the cold storage by the remarks made by Dr. Johnson, and the resurrection actually took place only in the 20th century. Professor Grierson brought out a volume of poems entitled The Poetical Works of John Donne. It was in 1912, and it came to the attention of T.S. Eliot, and Eliot hailed the metaphysical poets as models to be followed by all budding poets. And when we examine the life of John Donne, we come to find that Donne was born in a Catholic family in London. And his father, John Donne, died when he was only 4 years of age. And his mother, Elizabeth Haywood, was the daughter of a playwright named John Haywood, who produced the 4 pieces. And John Haywood is popular for his play called the 4 pieces. And Donne's mother was the daughter of the playwright John Haywood. And she was also the great niece of Sir Thomas More. And Sir Thomas More, so we know that he was the one who produced the great book called Utopia. and the mother of John Donne was the niece of Sir Thomas More. And after completing his studies at Oxford University and Cambridge, Donne accompanied the Earl of Essex in the expedition of Cadiz. He also joined with the Earl of Essex in the expedition of Cadiz. And later, Donne became private secretary to Sir Thomas Egerton. And during the time, he got secretly married with Anne Moore, the niece of his boss, and it made him lose his job. And years later, Donne became a priest, and he was appointed as the Dean of St. Paul's, and delivered many famous sermons also. And Donne was very fond of making epigrams. And there are many epigrams produced by Donne. And Isaac Walton, a great biographer of the period, produced a biography of John Donne, and he tells that when Donne lost his job, he wrote epigrammatically to his wife, John Donne, and Donne, and undone. And the lines appear in Donne's poem, Hymn to God the Father. And Donne was very fond of making epigrams. And when he lost his job, so he wrote it to his wife, John Donne, and Donne, and undone. And the line can be found in his poem, Hymn to God the Father. And in the last months of 1623, Donne had a serious illness. And he wrote a series of poems during his sickness. And they are titled Devotions Upon Emergent Occasions. And this is a very popular collection produced by John Donne. And the poems were written during his convalescence. And another meditations, meditation number 17, contains popular phrases like, no man is an island, and for whom the bell tolls. So very interestingly, these themes were used by popular writers. So the theme, no man is an island, was used as title for a novel by Thomas Merton. And for whom the bell tolls has been used as a title by Ernest Hemingway for a novel. And Donne's earliest poems are noted for eroticism, highly sexual. For example, in Elegy number 19, so he says, in that poem, he says, about undressing his wife and fondling his wife, comparing it with the exploration of America. And the poem is titled, To His Mistress Going to Bed. And I told you the earliest poems produced by Donne were noted for eroticism, over-sexuality. And in a poem entitled, To His Mistress Going to Bed, and it is called Elegy number 19. And there he makes a reference to his wife, and he speaks about fondling her, entertaining her, like the exploration of America. And in Elegy number 18, and Elegy number 19 actually speaks about the poet fondling his wife, comparing it with the exploration of America. And in Elegy number 18, he compares the gap between his lover's breast to the Hellespont. He compares the gap between the breast of his wife to the Hellespont. And towards the end of his life, he showed courage to challenge death. And its best example can be found in his holy sonnet number 10. Death, be not proud, and towards the end of his life, Donne showed the courage to challenge death. And the best example can be found in his sonnet number 10. And there he speaks, death, be not proud. Though some had called thee, there are people who called you proud, mighty and dreadful. There may be people referring to you as mighty and dreadful. For thou art not so, But as far as I am concerned, you are not so, you are not dreadful or you are not mighty. And death was belittled by Donne in his poem. He even had the courage to challenge death. And just before his death, so it is believed that he rose up from his sickbed to give his final sermon. Death's dual sermon, it is called. And it is attended by King Charles I also. Donne usually to give very powerful sermons. Just before his death, he rose from his sickbed and went to deliver his final sermon. And the sermon is very popular, Death's Dual Sermon. And this sermon was attended by King Charles I. And there are two poems prescribed for your study. One is the canonization, and the other one is a valediction forbidding mourning. And this is time that we go in to find the poem canonization. And it's a very popular poem produced by John Donne. In his poem canonization, Donne speaks eloquently about his love. And he poo-poos the attempts of others to ridicule him and his beloved. And there are people who try to ridicule him and his beloved. And there are people who describe them as candles fast burning out. In this poem, Donne speaks eloquently about his love. And there are people who try to belittle their love. And they ridicule the poet and his lover as candles fast burning out. The love between the poet and his lady will not last for a long time. So it will be burned out soon. They are almost like candles fast burning out. And some see in them an eagle dove pair. And there are people who find in them an eagle dove pair and unmatched pair. How an eagle is supposed to go with a dove? And the love relation between the poet and his wife is almost like the love between an eagle and dove. And according to Donne, these metaphors are not proper. So the similes are not proper. And in his opinion, the Phoenix legend suits them much more. There are people who regard their love as candles fast burning out. And there are the other people who maintain the view that the love between the poet and his lover is almost like the love between the eagle and dove. And Donne is of the opinion that the Phoenix legend suits them much more. And they are really one integrated soul. And it is believed that when the phoenix will be dead, the next phoenix will come out of its ashes. And there will be one phoenix at a time. And the phoenix legend is suitable to describe their love. They are really one integrated soul. The phoenix was supposed to be a single bird living in Arabia. And the new phoenix is supposed to come out from the ashes of the old phoenix. And the story of the phoenix had become popular during the Renaissance. And this may be the reason why he uses the conceit of the phoenix. The story of the phoenix actually had become very popular during the period of Donne. And Donne does not stop up with this reference to the phoenix. So he expresses his firm conviction that he and his lady will be declared saints after their deaths. So he compares his love with the image of the phoenix, and that they have become one integrated soul. Even though they are two bodies, they are one integrated soul. Like the phoenix coming out from the ashes of the other phoenix. That there will be only one phoenix at a time. And here we come to find that there are the two. And even though they are two bodies, they have an integrated soul. and Donne does not stop with the phoenix example, and he goes to describe that he and his wife will be regarded by the future generation as saints. They will be declared saints after their deaths. And the title of the poem actually refers to it. So it's a way of combining the spiritual and the physical form of love. And this is what Dr. Johnson maintained, the yoking together of heterogeneous things. The title of the poem actually refers to the canonization of the poet and his wife. And he comes to say that after death, the people will regard them as saints. T.S. Eliot's comment on John Donne is beautifully illustrated in this poem. And the subject matter of the poem is actually the emotion called love. But it is subjected to close logical analysis. And we have thus a fusion of emotion and thought in this poem. We find the fusion of emotion and thought. And according to T.S. Eliot, no English poet after Donne had attempted this. And while Milton and Dryden wrote poetry of thought, Wordsworth and Keats wrote poetry of emotion. So it was only John Donne who unified thought and emotion. When Milton and Dryden wrote the poetry of thought and excluded emotion, and when Wordsworth and Keats wrote poetry of emotion and excluded thoughts, Donne and the metaphysical poets fused thought and emotion in their poetry. In fact, Eliot accuses these poets, Milton, Dryden, Wordsworth, and Keats, for hijacking English poetry from its straight path. They have actually hijacked English poetry from its straight path. So if the people followed John Donne, there would have been the fusion of thought and emotion in later poetry. But Dr. Johnson accused them of yoking together heterogeneous facts and left them in the cold storage. And the poets that followed after Donne, like Milton and Dryden, actually hijacked the poetry. So they wrote poetry of thought and left out emotion. And at a later stage in the Romantic Revival, poets like Wordsworth and Keats wrote poetry of imagination, and they avoided thoughts. They considered only emotion and left out thoughts. And these poets all hijacked poetry from its straight path. And in Donne's poetry, we always find a half-serious and half-mocking tone. And the sublime and the ridiculous are blended together. So in the poems of Donne, we come to find the fusion of the sublime and the ridiculous. In his poetry, there is the blending of the sublime and the ridiculous. Things of sublimity and the ridiculous things are conjoined in the poems of John Donne. And this is the one poem entitled Canonization. And there's also one more poem prescribed in the HSSC syllabus, and it is Valediction Forbidding Morning. And actually, the poet is now planning to leave his wife for a short vacation. And he actually wants to go for his diplomatic services, and therefore he wants a few days to be away from his wife. And after all, normally when the husband and the wife are supposed to be getting separated even for a short time, so they may have strong feelings. The wives are supposed to be crying at the departure of their husbands. And the poet now wants his wife to stop mourning on their departure. So he wants his wife, to stop mourning on their separation. And the poet begins by comparing love between him and his beloved with the passing away of virtuous men. So their separation is almost like the passing away of virtuous men. Such men expire so peacefully. So the separation between his wife and himself should be like the peaceful death of the virtuous men. And here we come to find a conceit. So the separation is compared to the death of the virtuous men. And the poet begins by comparing love between him and his beloved with the passing away of virtuous men. And such men expire so peacefully that their friends can't even determine whether they are truly dead. As far as the virtuous people are concerned, the friends even will not understand whether they are dead, and they don't have such strong feelings at their death. And they may pass away very peacefully. And the separation between the poet and his wife should be in the same manner, that no one should understand that they are separated, that the poet has gone and the wife is left alone. And it should be like the passing away of virtuous men. When virtuous men are dead, no one will understand that they are dead. And the separation between the poet and his wife should be like the passing away of virtuous men. And the poem begins with the line, as virtuous men pass mildly away and whisper to their souls to go, while some of their sad friends do say, the breath goes now, and some say no, and there may be people surrounding the dead virtuous men that they are dead, and there are the others who say no, the virtuous man is not dead. And the separation between the poet and his wife should be like this. So when they become separated, people should never know that there has happened a separation. And the poem actually begins with the line, as virtuous men pass mildly away. So they pass mildly away. They pass gently away and whisper their souls to go. Some other sad friends do say, the breath goes now. There are the friends who may say that the breath goes now, and there are the other friends who say that the soul has not gone. So let us melt and make no noise. So what the poet wants is, wife, let us melt, let us separate and make no noise, no tear floods, and there is no tear floods needed, and nor sigh tempest, and tempest are compared to sighs, and no need of grieving and leaving sighs. So it were profanation of our joys. And if we do so, when I leave you, and if you cry loudly, and if you heave out your sighs, it will be like a profanation of our joys. So it will be like curtailment of, so stopping of our joys, to tell the laity, to tell the common people of our love. So if you cry loudly, and if you give out sigh tempest, the people may say that, so the laity may say that their love is only like this. This much is their love. And after all, the poet now comes to say, earthquakes bring harm and fear, but such fears should not affect his beloved. So there are earthquakes that bring harm and fear, but such fears should not affect his beloved. Because of the fame nature of their love, there are the harm and fear produced by earthquakes. But such fears should not affect his beloved because of the fame nature of their love. And he compares himself and his wife. Towards the end, he compares his wife and himself to the two legs of a compass. And before that, we come to find the lines. I will read the lines for you. Moving of the earth brings harms and fears. Men reckon what it did and meant. If there is earthquake, people will come to understand that the earthquake has happened. And he comes to say dull, sublunary love is love. And this is one very important point. Dull, sublunary love is love. And he compares the love of others as dull and they are sublunary and below the lunar region. Lunar region is actually the region of the moon. And the love of others is just sublunary love below the lunar region. But their love is above the lunar. Dull sublunary love is love. So cannot admit absence. And love by the laity, the common people, to be called sublunary love. And Donne actually refers to sublunary love of the laity, the common people. Normally, a husband and a wife will cry when they become separated. And their love is a sublunary love, love below the region of the solar, below the solar region. And this is sublunary, only earthly love. So it is only earthly love, it will not go up. And their love is actually love of the greatest measure, love of the greatest sins. And the love of the common people seem to be sublunary love. And such people cannot admit absence. In the case of such people, they can't admit absence. If the husband goes away from the wife, the wife and the husband could not accept absence. And in their case, the love is of a greatest value so that there is no need for crying. But we by a love so much refined. But as far as the poet and his wife are concerned, they have a love that is much refined, that ourselves know not what it is. And even ourselves do not know what kind of a love that we entertain between ourselves. And our two souls, therefore, should move like the two legs of a compass. So towards the end of the poem, Donne compares himself and his wife with the two legs of a compass. We know that there are two legs for a compass. And if we use a compass for making a circle, we keep one leg stand firm, and the other leg is used in making the circle. And they are joined at the top. When we find a compass, we find that they are joined at the top. The legs are joined at the top. And she is perfectly grounded at the center point. Actually, the lady is the fixed leg and it stands in the center. And the other leg moves farther from the center and she leans towards him. When the leg moves around, the leg that stands in the center leans towards the moving leg. And as he travels in his circles, she remains the same. The strong leg remains firm, and it is his wife. And the wife who stands as the center leg makes his circle perfect. His circle becomes perfect when the center leg stands firm. So, and he comes to compare himself and his wife as the two legs of a compass. And when the center leg stands firm, the other leg moves around and makes the circle. And when the center leg is firm, the circle will also become perfect. And such will thou be to me, who must like the other foot obliquely run. The firmness draws my circle just, and the firmness of the central leg will help my circles just and makes me end where I begin and makes me end where I started. So, and he compares he and his wife as the two legs of a compass. And this is the reason why the poem has been titled A Valediction. Actually, this is a speech forbidding, asking to stop mourning. There is no need to mourn on the separation of the husband. When Donne is asked to leave his wife for a short while. Normally, the ladies may cry when the husband will leave her. And as far as the poet and his wife are concerned, their love is a kind of a supreme love, a superb kind of love. And it is not like a sublunary love of the common people. The common people are entertaining sublunary love or earthly love below the lunar region. But their love remains in the lunar region. So supreme kind of love. And therefore, they should never make a heaving or a sighing or crying at the time when they are asked to depart. And therefore, he wants his wife to stop mourning on his separation. And these two poems are prescribed for your study. And once HSST asked the question, the line, dull sublunary love is found in which poem? And in the poem, Valediction Forbidding Mourning, we come to find the reference to dull sublunary. It's to be pronounced as sublunary, not of the lunary level, but below the lunary level. It is earthly love. And he compares his love as lunary love and the love of the common people as sublunary, below the lunar region. It is only earthly love. And actually, in the case of the poet and his wife, there is no need to show their feelings at the time of departure. And the people may regard their love as a supreme kind of love if they separate without mourning and shedding of tears. And these are the details we find from Valediction Forbidding Mourning and from the poem Canonization. And thank you for the time. ഞാൻ ഒന്ന് രണ്ട്